Nokia 5110.
Do you speak through here?
No.
What's that? Wait, hello?
Do you remember the last time you've seen this phone? Do you remember when these phones were meant for, calling? And the only game we had on our phones was, like, Snake? Then came SMS, Wi-Fi, a gazillion apps. And suddenly, we rely on our phones for everything in our lives. Sometimes, everything, except calling. Technology certainly has revolutionized our world and our daily lives. It's created amazing tools and resources that we no longer can do without. We have a world of information at our fingertips. Everything is easier, faster, better, more portable, and more fun. Technology has sure changed our lives. But it has also changed the lives of the next generation forever. Kids today are almost thrust right into social media once they come out of the womb. Their entire lives, starting from birth, are documented and uploaded and shared and liked. School doesn't even really work with pen and paper anymore. It's online lessons and homework on tablets and digital presentations. For decades, technology has been heralded as bringing about a paradigm shift in how we teach and learn. The COVID-19 situation quickly demonstrated the importance of the virtual classroom, which allows students to learn from practically anywhere. And yet, for all the significant progress technology is supposed to bring about, it seems to have also backfired. Because kids are simply spending too much time on their screens. Suddenly, what our parents said about not watching too much television because it will hurt our eyesight starts to make sense. Except with our kids, it's worrying about the blue light exposure instead. Our eyes' natural filters are not meant to cope with prolonged exposure to blue light. Eye strain, burning sensations, headaches, and physical and mental fatigue are just the tip of the iceberg of related issues collectively termed digital eye strain, or DES. Long-term exposure can even cause retinal damage and contribute to age-related macular degeneration, which can lead to loss of vision. But the other serious issue is that artificial blue light from our electronic devices affects our natural circadian rhythm by inhibiting melatonin production. In other words, extended use of these devices is keeping our children from a much-needed restful night's sleep. If you've always thought your kid on lesser sleep wakes up moody and cranky, you're not wrong. Science backs this up. An article in Translational Psychiatry says that sleep disturbance is an important factor contributing to the onset and maintenance of mood disorders. When our children's sleep is disturbed, they're not able to complete a full circadian cycle. This suppresses their behavior and biological processes and leads to anxiety, stress, negative moods, depression symptoms, and bipolar disorder. And blue light is the strongest environmental influencer of our circadian rhythms. Besides an increased risk for depression, Harvard researchers have even linked exposure to blue light at night to obesity, diabetes, heart disease, and several types of cancer. However, the most immediate issue threatening our children is that excessive use of digital devices takes a toll on their brains. Today's research shows that giving too much attention to digital screens weakens our brain's ability to process information, focus, make decisions, and control thoughts. Brain scans actually show a reduction in gray matter, which spells trouble for learning, and disrupted white matter pathways, which compromises how we process our emotions. And the mental and health problems caused are even worse when it comes to children, because their minds and bodies are still developing. What can we do then as parents? Well, before we even stop our kids from spending excessive time on their screens, we have to manage our own screen time. One way to teach our kids that free time doesn't automatically equal screen time is to show it by example. Dinner time should be focused on the meal and having meaningful conversations about our day. Yes, that means us putting our phones away, even if it means ignoring work calls and Facebook notifications. We'll live. After dinner, instead of immediately all retreating to our own individual screens, we can read a book or do some coloring. Yes, adult coloring books are all the rage now as they reduce stress. After dinner time is also great for family time. Think board games, card games, or even taking a walk together around the neighborhood in the evening breeze. We're not gonna lie, this isn't going to be easy. It's hard enough to tear ourselves away from our screens, much less do this consistently every day, in order to set the right example as role models for our children. But stick to it, because small, consistent efforts build good habits. And after a while, your children will learn that free time doesn't automatically mean time to waste their brain cells away in front of a mind-numbing screen. Especially when there are so many other fun alternatives that also leave them feeling happier and more emotionally satisfied. Besides, managing screen time doesn't have to feel like a restriction. It can actually be an opportunity to empower our children to make the right decisions. For example, a UNICEF study, as well as most pediatricians, recommend no more than 2 hours of screen time a day for school-going children. Using these 2 hours as a guide, we can then get our children to decide how they want to split this up. 15 minutes before school, 45 minutes after school, and 1 hour after dinner? Sure, why not? It's up to them. The trick to not saying no all the time is to create situations like this where we'll be happy to say yes. Giving children the opportunity to plan their own screen time schedule helps them take responsibility for their own time, actions, and behavior. It also empowers them to be in control of making their own decisions, instead of a top-down approach as parents restricting their access. You can also reward your child when they keep to the limits they set for themselves. It shows great maturity, so tell them how proud you are of them. This not only helps them feel proud of their own decisions and actions, but also boosts their self-confidence to take greater control over their own lives and decisions in future. After all, we don't want to raise children who just listen well. What we want is to raise independent thinkers with the skills to succeed in their own hands. If you feel that this video has helped you in one way or another, be sure to share it so fellow parents get to know this important information. Thank you for watching, and be sure to subscribe to our channel because we will be launching new informative parenting videos every week. See you next time!